First week we said what is required is people who know what it is to be content. We looked at Luke chapter 9 about the contentment that Jesus Christ offers. This morning I want to give you a second answer to that question. Piecing together a great family requires people who love. People who love. When I think of the word love, I think of a particular man. His name is Robertson McQuilkin. Robertson McQuilkin. I was a student at Columbia Bible College. During those days, Robertson McQuilkin was the president of Columbia Bible College and Seminary. 10 years after I graduated from the school, Robertson McQuilkin faced a very significant decision. A very significant decision. At this time, he was 57 years old. It's 1990. He was 57 years old, and his ministry had taken off. So he's the president of a thriving college. He's the president of a thriving seminary. He had authored several books that didn't just kind of fly under the radar. They caught people's attention. Consequently, he was a sought-after speaker. If you wanted Robertson McQuilkin to come speak at your conference or at your church, you had to book him not one, not two, but 3 years in advance. His ministry was going crazy. It was also in 1990 that he celebrated 40 years of marriage to his wife, Muriel. Muriel was also a woman that was involved in ministry. She had a thriving radio ministry. In fact, there was talk of national syndication of a radio broadcast. But 10 years earlier, they noticed some changes taking place in Muriel. They would laugh about it at first when she would tell the same story twice in the same conversation. But as years moved forward, her condition got worse and worse. I mean, she got to the place where she couldn't remember details. I mean, hers was a Christian radio broadcast, and sometimes she had trouble remembering the names of the four gospel writers. She was unable to put together complete sentences. Eventually, she lost her ability to paint. She was known for painting these beautiful portraits. And it was in the latter part of the 1980s that she was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. It was, Robertson said, it was painless for her. And she didn't even know it was happening. In fact, he said there were times they would watch commercials on TV about Alzheimer's, and she would kind of laugh and say, I wonder if that'll ever happen to me. But it was incredibly painful for Robertson to watch this woman that he loved, this woman who was vibrant and full of life, growing more and more dim. It was around 1980 that he was faced with a decision. He writes it this way. So began years of struggle with the question of what should be sacrificed. Ministry or caring for my wife? I mean, Jesus said, whoever would come after me must hate his mother and father, his wife and children. Should I put the kingdom of God first? Hate my wife and for the sake of the kingdom of Christ? Arrange for her to be institutionalized. But he also noticed that Muriel was most content when she was with him. In fact, in the moments that he was absent, she was fearful, if not stricken with terror. But while he was making this decision, the school provided some live-in help for them so that he could continue his duties as president while he decided what he would do. And he said it was not uncommon for her to walk 10 times a day to see him at his office. He worked on the campus of Columbia Bible College. His house was just a mile walk. 10 times a day she would make that journey. He said, in fact, some evenings when he would help her get undressed, he noticed that her feet were bloodied. He told the doctor about this, and the doctor teared up and said, such love, such love. What was he to do? Ministry or marriage? Well, when it came time for him to finally make the decision, He said the decision was easy for him. Integrity, fairness, and love informed his choice. He says it like this. When the time came, the decision was firm. It took no great calculation. It was a matter of integrity. Had I not promised 42 years before, in sickness and in health, till death do us part? Not only was it a matter of integrity, it was a matter of fairness. This was no grim duty to which I was stoically resigned. However, it was only fair. She had, after all, cared for me for almost four decades with marvelous devotion. Now it was my turn. Such a partner she was. If I took care of her another 40 years, I would never be out of her debt. But there was more than just integrity and duty. It also was a matter of love. He said it like that. It's all more than keeping promises and being fair, however. As I watched her brave descent into oblivion, Muriel is the joy of my life. Daily I discern new manifestations of the kind of person she is, the wife I have always loved. I also see fresh manifestations of God's love, the God I love, long to love more fully. And with that, Robertson McQuilkin chose marriage and he stepped back from ministry for the sake of integrity and fairness, but more than anything, for the sake of love. I got to watch the two of them. My wife can tell you stories about us watching him tenderly care for his wife in her declining days. Such an example of love. And every time I walked away from them, I walked away with a sense that I want to be like that. I want to be a man not just consumed by love, but a man who loves other people, who loves my wife like that, who loves my family like that, who loves people like that. I want to be a person of love. And quite frankly, my kids need that. My kids need a dad that loves them like that. I mean, you know, when you have kids, nobody has kids and looks at this little bundle of joy and thinks, how can I screw this thing up? You know, nobody wants to do that. I want my kids to grow up and be healthy people who know how to relate in a healthy way to the world around them. And to do that, they need a family. They need a dad who knows how to love. Frankly, my marriage needs that. My marriage needs love. I remember when Stacy and I first met, and I remember how quickly I fell in love with my wife. I remember the jubilation I felt on the day that we stood at the altar and I got to say, I do. You know, but then you know, you get into marriage and you find out that you don't always see eye to eye. You know, you have these little spats, sometimes bigger than little spats. And by the grace of God, we've always been able to work through and genuinely resolve those things. But you begin to realize that for our marriage to survive, it's going to take more than the kind of romantic Hollywood fairy tale kind of love that we had initially. We've got to have a deeper love in order for our marriage to survive for the long haul. My marriage needs that kind of love. My kids need that kind of love. You know, frankly, the world needs that kind of love. I mean, people all the time are asking the question, how do I know God's real? How do I know God really exists? And you ask me, and I'm quick to kind of point to the evidence, historic evidence of the resurrection of Christ. And I mean, I think that's good, but I believe there's a better answer than that, than just the historic evidence. I think you ought to be able to point to your life. I mean, the Bible says that when a person enters into a relationship with God, God transforms that person. Galatians chapter 5 says one of the ways he transforms you is into a person who loves. And when somebody says, how do I know God exists? I ought to be able to say, look at my life. Like, I ought to be a wreck. But I genuinely love people. Come to my house. Have dinner with my family. Listen to the joy around the table. And if you can figure out how that happens apart from Christ, I'm all ears. I mean, the love of God, the world needs to see that. And so I come to you this morning with this question. And that's, how can I become a man who genuinely loves and loves other people? How do you love other people? That's the question that John is answering in John chapter 1, chapter 4. I mean, John is writing this little epistle to deal with a number of errors. And so chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, after introducing the book, chapter 1 and verse 5 through chapter 2 and verse 27, he addresses a number of different areas, teaches the church how to deal with errors. And then in chapter 2, verse 28 through the end of chapter 3, he talks about what a genuine obedience looks like. Come to chapter 4, verses 1 through 6, again, he returns to addressing error and the matter of truth. There's truth, and then there's error, and this is how you recognize it. But when he comes to chapter 4 and verse 7, he begins for the first time in the book addressing love. He teaches people how to love. And this is what he says. Look in verse 7. He says, "Dear friends, let us love one another. Here's why. Love comes from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." In this passage, I find three essential things to becoming a family characterized by love, or to becoming a person who's characterized by love. And the first is this: building a loving family, becoming a loving person requires hearing the command to love. Hearing the command to love. Don't miss this. Chapter 4 and verse 7, he begins, "Dear friends, let us love one another." Let us love. In Greek, it's not a suggestion. It's not even an invitation. Let us love is a command. And more than just being this command to be a loving person, that command includes a direct object. Let us not just be a loving person, but let us love one another. We are called, we are commanded to love one another. The point is more than just seeing a command. The point is hear the command. Something you hear is something you remember and something you act on. It's something that you consider carefully and you purpose to bring your life into alignment with. Here, what I'm saying is, if you don't hear the command, you're never going to change your life. It's like going to the doctor. And imagine you get your physical done, he does all your stuff, and he says, one of the things you might want to consider doing is losing a little weight. You know, how many of you hear that? Go out and go on a diet. Like, none of us. But the doctor says, "Dude, you're overweight. If you don't lose weight, you're going to be dead in 6 months. You know, that's a command. Lose weight. How many of us, when we hear that, will go out in at least for a week or two? You know, that's how we have to hear this. If you're going to change, if you're going to be different, you've got to really hear what God's saying. And that's, dude, love one another. So let me ask you a question. When people get around you, when people interact with you, maybe the sales clerk at Walmart, the guy at the automotive store, somebody sitting next to you in a cubicle, or your kids at home, your parents, when they get around you, do they learn more about love or more about hate? When people get around you, do they learn more about love or do they learn more about hate? If they're learning more about hate, are you ready to do something about it? That's what it means to hear the command. So if you want to build a loving family, it requires hearing the command to love. But it requires a second thing, and that's understanding the definition of love. What is love? I mean, our culture talks about love all the time, but what exactly is love? John answers that question in verse 10. Verse 10, he says, so you want to know what love is? This is love. So which signals there's a definition of love coming. You want a definition of love? Here it is. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. What John is saying is if you'll think about that line, then you will come up with a definition of love. So what does that line teach us about love? One of the things it teaches us about love is that love is more than a feeling. I think love is a feeling. I think it's this sense of gladness, this delight. It's not just a duty that you do. It's this gladness. But it's more than a feeling. It actually is an action, which is reflected in the words, God loved and sent. He did something. So just as it's true for God, it's true for us. Love is an action. Love is also sacrifice. Love is sacrifice. Jesus not only took an act, but his act was to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins. What does that mean? Well, it goes back to verse 9. In verse 9, John says that God sent his one and only Son so that we might live through him. God's desire for your life and for my life is that we really live, which means two things. One, the word live refers to this quality of life that he wants us to experience. All of us exist, but very few people really live, know what fulfillment is and satisfaction and contentment. That's what God wants for us. He wants us to live this quality of life and this quantity of life. He wants us to live, and that forever. Well, why is it that we don't live? Which is where verse 10 comes into play. It's because of this sin. We are sinners, atoning sacrifice for our sins. Our sins separates us from the life that's available through God. I mean, he wants us to live, but because of our sin, our disobedience to him, we are separated from him. And we can't live. So what can be done? God sent an atoning sacrifice, which was Jesus Christ. Jesus came, died on a cross, the wrath of God that we deserved, the punishment that we deserved, Jesus absorbed and paid for on the cross. And now through faith in him, we trust Christ as our Savior, that life is ours. But more than just an explanation of the gospel, John is answering, what is love? That illustrates for us that love is an action, a sacrificial action. Also, from the verse, I learned that love is unconditional. He says, this is love, not that we loved God. The verb tense, not that we loved God, refers to this action that happened in the past and continues into the future. What John is saying is, we haven't loved God in the past, and we still don't love him. It doesn't mean that we never do loving things towards God, but it means that the trajectory of our life, the majority of our life, is giving to not loving him and continually not loving him. But what does God do? Though we don't love him, God loved us, which means that God's love for us is not based on our action, is not based on our response. It is unconditional, which should characterize our love for other people. Like the people we love, it's not people that are just nice to us. The people we love are not necessarily the people that we like. The people we love are not the people who just give us good gifts, stuff. We love people unconditionally, regardless of the way that they treat us. I mean, periodically, I'll, hear people say something, I'm not going to give them a gift. Why? Well, they didn't give me a gift. Well, that's conditional love. The love that God calls us to do is unconditional love. So it's active, sacrificial, unconditional, and it's constant love. That's reflected in this word, that he loved us. It's more than just a one-time action. The verb reflects this ongoing state that God loved us and he continually loves us. Not just once or periodically, but God always loves us, which is the way we are to respond to other people. Our love is to be constant. And then finally, it's to be scriptural. Love is scriptural. So this point is very interesting to me, and it comes really out of the context. You know, our culture is constantly talking about love. You know, we ought to love one another. And in our culture, the word love really is a synonym for tolerate. We ought to tolerate each other or accept each other. Like, that's the definition of love. What is love? Is it just acceptance? Well, I find it interesting, the context of verse 7. You know, verses 1 through 6 are talking about truth and error. There is truth, and there is not truth. There's truth, and then there is error. Verses 1 through 6 say the truth is what's contained between the covers of your Bible. That's truth. Error is everything that is contrary to what's between the covers of your Bible. Which means, what is love? In context, love is helping people live according to that truth. If you want to know what it is to treat people lovingly, it's not accepting them. It's more than that. It's gently, patiently helping them to bring their life into line with this book. Which means, if I am encouraging someone to live in a way that is contrary to this book, I don't love them. I hate them. Love is scriptural. It is helping people bring their life into line with this word. If you want to know what accounts for love, what defines loving behavior, it's this book. So this is my definition of love. Love is gladly putting others first, even if it means sacrificing myself. Love is gladly. It's not just putting other people first, but it's this gladness, like Robertson McQuilkin had. You know, it's a duty, it's a matter of integrity, but it's much more than that. She is the joy of my life. I love her. And the opportunity to step back from ministry and invest in her for the rest of her life, man, it's not even a question. I mean, that's what genuine love is. It's this glad putting others first, even if it means sacrificing myself. Hearing the command to love, understanding the definition of love, but ultimately where the rubber meets the road is following the path to love. How is it that I become a loving person? And that's what verses 7 and 8 tell us. Dear friends, let's love one another. Well, how do you do that? Well, love comes from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who doesn't love doesn't know God, because God is love. John begins with this: all love comes from God. I mean, just like saying all heat comes from the sun, all love comes from God. All loving behavior has its ultimate origin in God. So how is it that I get connected with this origin of love, Almighty God? If God is love, how do I get connected with him? John says it takes two things. Everyone who loves, verse 7, everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The first thing required is you got to receive Christ. I mentioned a minute ago that my sin alienates me from God, the God of love, which means I can't become a loving person, because all love has its source in him. But when I receive Christ, I am born of God and become his child. And when I become his child, I am reconciled with him, which throws open the door to relationship with God. I mean, everyone that you ever lock eyes with is a creation of God. Everyone is a creation of God, but not everyone is a child of God. Only those who believe in Jesus Christ become children of God. So John says, if you want to love, you've got to be born of God. You've got to trust Christ as your Savior. But that's not it. That is the beginning. If you want to become a loving person, you receive Christ, and then secondly, you got to get to know Christ. You got to spend time with him. And it's as you spend time with him that you become more like him. God is love. You spend time around God, you become a loving person. What does it look like to get to know him? Craig Rochelle has a really good story that illustrates the point. Growing up, Craig Rochelle was a Kansas City Royals fan. And in 1980, he was a big fan of their third baseman, a guy named George Brett. You can imagine, so Craig Rochelle, 1980, is in high school. He knew all the stats about George Brett, you know, his batting average, everything. I mean, he's this rabid fan. So fast forward a couple years, he's in college. Craig Rochelle's in college. He's walking down the streets of Kansas City. He looks into this hamburger joint, and there's George Brett. He can't believe it. There's George Brett eating a hamburger. So he rushes in the hamburger joint, goes right up to George Brett, and he starts spouting all these statistics. He says, dude, I know everything about you. I know your batting average. So George Brett is eating lunch with, you know, some of his friends, and so his friends kind of stand up and politely try to get Craig Rochelle to leave because they're used to fans coming up. When George Brett speaks up, he says, Craig, you obviously know everything about me, but I know nothing about you. He pushes a chair back. He says, why don't you have a seat and let me get to know you? You know, in the same way Craig Rochelle sat down with George Brett to get to know each other, we got to do the same thing with the Lord. It's just sit down with him. You know, for me, that looks like morning by morning. I told you last time, it seems like everybody I talk to connects coffee to spirituality, right? So, which is true for me. So I get up in the morning and go to my, however you pronounce it, Keurig, and get a cup of coffee, go in the front room. There's my Bible and my reading glasses. And I open my Bible, and God begins to speak to me through his word. And I begin to speak back to him in prayer. And it's through that process that I get to know him. And because he's a God of love, without even realizing it's happening, my whole disposition gets changed. Here's what I'm trying to say. If you want to become a loving person, I would suggest you take three steps. One is that you contemplate God's love. I would encourage you to pull out 1 John 4:10 and verse 10. Day up verse 10 and just, you know, if John's saying this is love, do what I did with that verse. Ask, well, what does this teach me about love? When I asked that question, I mean, it taught me that love takes action, it's sacrificial, it's unconditional, constant, and it's scriptural. But you'll probably see so much more there. Contemplate love and ask yourself the question, am I this kind of person, and do I want to become this kind of person? If the answer is yes, you want to become a loving person, then the second thing you need to do is depend on God's Son. Everyone who loves is born of God. So some people want to become a loving person, and they think they need to turn over a new leaf, but there are a lot of people that need to turn over a whole new tree. Like, by that, I mean you can't become a loving person in and of yourself. It's going to take a relationship with God. And for you to have a relationship with God, you've got to believe in Christ first as your Savior. And then third, I'm trying to say to become a loving person, you've got to spend time in God's presence. You've got to connect with him. Let me just tell you, so there are some things I'll talk about on Sunday. You need to know that this, for me, is very personal, and I'm very passionate about this. And it's because the love that Robertson McQuilkin put on display with his wife Muriel is very different from the home I grew up in. So I grew up in a home that was marked by violence and yelling and hatred. So I remember as a kid suffering excessive punishment for very minor offenses. Like some of you came in the front door this morning. You see where all the kids had chalked all over the front entrance. So as a little kid, I did that, and I got beat so bad that the babysitter cried and left. I mean, the punishment I got was excessive. The violence in my home was horrific. I can remember as a little kid peeking around the corner from the den in the kitchen to see my father with his hands around my mother's neck. My home was constantly filled with loud screaming and objects flying through the air. My home was not loving. And the only thing that kind of calmed the atmosphere was when I was, I guess, about eight years old, my parents got a divorce, which you would think, man, that's a good thing. But it actually made life worse for me. I read a statistic online that says, as a thorough body of research has demonstrated, divorce often perpetuates itself across generations. Children of divorce are more likely to get divorced themselves than are people from intact families. So I'm raised in a family marked by violence and hatred, and then I'm the product of divorce, which means when it comes to a future marriage, dude, I'm toast. I am damaged goods. But then I met Jesus Christ. As a 17-year-old, somebody told me that God loves me and that I can be forgiven through faith in Christ. And I believed in Christ as my Savior. And then I began to spend time with God. And without even realizing what was happening, through time with Him, God was transforming me into His image. Not overnight, but little by little, He began to repair this damaged boy and transform me into somebody that knows how to love. My wife would tell you that Jesus did the same thing for her. And as a result, while it's not supposed to be the case, we have not a perfect marriage, but we have a healthy marriage. We have a healthy marriage. I mean, we have our disagreements, but we're able to negotiate those disagreements. We don't yell and scream at each other. There's no violence in my home. And if you ask my kids, they'll tell you that they grew up in a loving family. It was interesting. I asked my daughter yesterday, because I want to be able to say that with integrity. I said, Danny, do you feel like you grew up in a loving home? And she said, yeah. And she said, just last week I met a guy, guy working at a place she started working in, and he asked her what the family was like she grew up in, and she said, well, I grew up a pastor's kid. And he immediately responded, oh, that's so bad. Oh, pastor's kid. Oh, man, that environment, that's terrible. And she said, I had to beg to differ. Like, I love the family I grew up in. I love being home. And my kids, they do love being home. I guess my point is that through faith in Christ and time with Him, Jesus has completely changed the whole trajectory of Stacy and my marriage. And He'll do the same thing for you. Some of you here this morning are in marriages that are in shambles, like violence and anger, yelling marks, how you relate to each other. It doesn't have to be that way. And some of you grew up in families that were extremely dysfunctional, and you never knew what it is to love. You are not damaged goods, and life doesn't have to end that way. If through faith in Christ and through spending time with Him, He will transform you into someone who loves. If you want to become a loving person, it takes this longing, hearing God's command to love. And then it takes understanding the definition of love. So you know where he wants to move you. And finally, it takes following his path. You do that, and you will rejoice in the way God transforms you into somebody who really loves. Let me pray for us.